police. We know that, especially in the neighborhood I represent in North St. Louis, like, we need police officers. Our response when we do call on police is super short. But I think the change is needed. It's hard to just pick one thing. It's a huge culture change that needs to happen in the police department.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, go back to the history of police officers and in communities of colors. Once upon a time, they were the slave catchers, right? So I think it is a culture change. I still don't understand why, you know, police have this kind of blue line thing. You know, they hold the blue line above anything. It's like this. I get fraternities and sororities, but when you're talking about a group of individuals that are supposed to protect and serve, no matter who they are, and they have like this oath of brotherhood that we will always make sure that whatever happens in our locker room stays in our locker room type thing, it isn't healthy for trying to figure out how do we create change. And we haven't seen a change. We continue to be tough on crime, but not smarter on crime. We continue to not really build strong relationships with communities that need it the most. And we say, oh, we need law enforcement to go in there and crack down on crime. Well, we know crime is deeper than just law enforcement. You're talking about poverty. You're talking about education. You're talking about social services that have been cut, and especially in this coronavirus, being cut even more. So I think it's a huge culture change that has to happen from individuals like me and Lisa, who serve on a role where we affect policy. But I think it's also individuals like officers who, you know a lot of insight on the wrongs that can inform folks like us or people in the community to say these are the things that, you know, need to be pushed and change that need to be made.
So a lot of police, there are a lot of police officers that hold that blue line, but they're, and now I think a lot of police officers are getting away from the blue line because they're getting involved in the prosecution now too. If you know what I mean. If one commits a crime and the other was there, he's getting committed too. So a lot of people are staying away from that blue line, but they're still there. I agree with you. We got to break that line.
So in terms of other policies, you know, I think especially with some of this stuff that we're talking about sort of this culture of secrecy and silence that exists within police departments, I think, and I'm learning about all of this stuff because a lot of it gets really technical, but I think that there is a lot of opportunity for us to really dig into some of these contracting issues and these collective bargaining agreement issues, because there is a lot that I think that is upheld within these CBAs, as they call them, which definitely kind of goes back to police unions. And you know, I know, for example, right now in St. Louis County, we have a CBA for the sergeants that I think is in the process of being negotiated right now. And as a policymaker, I know I'm going to have to be asked to sign off on that. Well, I'm not going to just rubber stamp that. I want to see what's in there, and I want to fully understand what's in there. And so, you know, that's where I think there's a huge opportunity to look into some of these things and some of this culture of secrecy and policies that really are intentional about supporting that we need to identify and dismantle.
It's just, we really look at law enforcement more held higher standards than anybody, even our own military. You know, folks come back home from the military and we forget all about them. They have all these issues, PTSD, they done lost limbs, and we kind of throw them away. But with police, there's a police involved situation. And I think really what's a huge part of that is a police union. You know, unions are great and I'm all for, you know, people having representation, but the police union is so entrenched and it's so heavy armed that it's hard to, I feel like that part of the union isn't really looking out for, you know, unions are meant to look out for everybody, of course the workers, but everybody, but they only look out for the police and they rally in a way of dividing. And unions have historically been to bring people together, uplift injustices, to make sure that people have a voice, and have been kind of fighting back against the bad guys. But what you've seen from the police union, especially here in the city of St. Louis, when you have a business manager like Jeff Rorta, when the day Mike Brown is killed on August 4th, he say, happy Jern Wilson Day. You know, it's only creating more division and it's only giving ammo to officers, and not all officers are bad, but the ones that are, to feel like they are emboldened to do some of these actions that they are. So I think we really need to also, you know, look at how these unions have such a stronghold when it comes to contract negotiation and when it comes to dictating the narrative when these actions are happening. They're not coming to the streets talking to the protesters and trying to figure out how do we create a better solution. They double down and behind police officers and make, honestly, situations even more worse.
But aren't we in at-will state? Aren't we in at-will state, which means you can get fired? They can fire you, right? That's what I thought.
Yeah, we're at will state, but I think what I'm saying, when it does come to the police union, because no matter if you have a union, yes, you can get fired, and unions are there to represent you. But the police union, it's almost like folks don't even want to go against the police union because most unions all get very political if it's in campaigning and or if you're running for office or even not in the community. But it's just something about the police union and their stronghold that they have, which even if they get fired or if, you know, they're been suspended without pay, the police union instantly comes in and help them to make sure they get paid. If there's an officer involved shooting and they're charged, the police union instantly, you know, gets them out of jail. And you don't see that in other unions. And I used to work for SEIU as a union rep. You don't see that overprotection, this overfunding budget, that no matter what happens to an officer, even at an at-will state, that there is this body that is so forceful and so aggressive and so powerful, no matter what happens. And, you know, it's made to seem as if they wasn't wrong. And then they have resources to also kind of back up the police officers. So we are an at-will state. But when you look at all the unions, when you look at our service employee union, our carpenters union, and our police union, there's something different about our police union, that they have this stronghold on all other unions and kind of this right to do whatever they want, even if they are in the wrong. It's like, we were in the wrong, but we wasn't in the wrong.